Well, hello everyone.
Hi.
Finally, somebody says hello back. We're already in the last round of the second day. I'm hoping I can provide you some valuable information. Of course, you've been learning a lot these days about how to build optimal extensions, how to optimize your code. I in fact saw a session about how to learn PHP. But what is your website worth if nobody can see it? That's, I hope, where I can come in. There was a session this morning about inbound marketing. I will tap into that as well during this presentation, and I will add far more information in another way than he explained it about SEO. As you can see, the presentation is themed in Super Mario style. I'm sure many of you will know what Super Mario is. During previous times I gave this presentation, it occurred to me that some people actually don't know what Super Mario is. What you see behind me is Super Mario. He is the main character in a series of computer games that's released on the Nintendo console. I will use Super Mario and his associates in this presentation, including Every Plumber's Dream, because the goal of most Super Mario games is to find that princess. What better subject of a presentation could I have chosen than something that is desired to be found by these guys? Both Mario, Wario and Luigi will be featured in this presentation. Each of them will have a different set of tactics they will use to get the princess to them. They will use these tactics, SEO tactics, in a way, hoping to find the princess so that they can be together and be happily ever after. But how can they find the princess? After all, as Toad was telling us in the Super Mario game, the princess is always in another castle. That's inconvenient, because if you're in the first castle and she's in the second, you will never meet. However, there's a solution if you can't find what you're looking for. It's what half the world is doing these days. Well, the entire world that has a computer. They use Google. I know a term that each and every one of you have used in Google, and I will spoil it. It's neither Joomla nor related to naked women. It's your own name. Please raise your hands who has searched on Google for their own name. 80% score, I guess. You're in good company. Even princesses search for their own name. During this presentation, I will use the princess as a placeholder for your target audience. While Mario, Luigi, and Wario are trying to get the princess to find them in hopes of building a relationship with her, you have a different target audience. Perhaps you're selling water bottles, fire extinguishers, or curtains. Each and every one of you will have a target audience that you wish you had more of on your website, so that you could interact more and perhaps sell more of your products. If you are number one on a certain keyword, that is the place you will be at, and that is the place you will want to be at. The number one result in Google has the highest click-through rate. What the click-through rate is a percentage of the people that are looking for a certain term, in my case Princess Peach, and divided by the amount of people that click on a certain result. This one has the highest amount of people clicking, followed by these down. If you're on that first spot, the princess, or in your case, your target audience, will find your website and you will have a chance to interact with him, her, or whatever your target audience might be to sell your products. What these men will do is they will use Joomla as a platform to build that website. During earlier times, I was preparing for this presentation and Joomla 1.5 was still out. In my opinion, Joomla 1.5 wasn't a really strong platform for SEO in its core. If you extended it with several extensions, you could get it up to par compared to other platforms or to a custom platform. But in its core, it wasn't powerful enough to fulfill any needs that you might have in regards to SEO. Joomla 1.6 has added a lot of great SEO features. Joomla 1.7 continue to do this, and Joomla 2.5 has added even more. Therefore, these guys are using Joomla 2.5 in its core without any added extensions in hopes of trying to make the princess find them. I have given each and every one of them a set of tactics, which I have named below their own name. Luigi gets spam hat, Wario gets black hat, and Mario gets white hat. Black hat and white hat are actually known terms in the SEO industry. Black hat is known as the illegal, the blackish, the SEO type that needs to remain hidden because it's actually forbidden by Google. Google has put terms of use online in which they state this you can't do if you want to rank in our system. Of course, it's a system. People want to manipulate it because they know that if you stand on the first result, you will sell more of your products than if you were on the last result. The white hat strategy, it's an open, clear, future-based, long-term strategy. And this one actually didn't exist, but if I didn't give that one a term as well, you might have been confused, so I had to make one up. What I have done is that I have used a different type of interface for each of the different tactics. I'm hoping this might group the data for you, so that if you're at home or tonight having a nice free sponsored beer, I'm not even sure if the beer is sponsored tonight, and you think back on this presentation, the grouping of the scenery might help you to place what kind of tactics you're using is. Is this a legal tactic? Is this an advice tactic? Or is this just a spam tactic, such as the one Luigi is using? Why did I choose the underground location to be Luigi's scenery? I, in fact, based that decision on the screen you're seeing behind me. For the people that played that game, this should be a familiar scene. For the persons that didn't, I will explain it. At the end of World 1, this screen is presented. What it does is present you an opportunity to go from World 1 directly into World 2, 3 or 4. It's called a warp zone. While this is of course great if you want to jump ahead and play level 4, this is a fast way to get there. You wouldn't have to defeat World 2 and 3 to get at World 4. The bad thing about this is that you didn't learn how to use the skills that need to be learned to pass level 2 and 3. That one jump that you might have learned on a smaller scale in level 2, you didn't do that because you skipped ahead and went directly to level 4. The same applies to SEO. If you're trying to take the shortcut and move straight ahead to World 4 by using tactics, well, based on shortcuts, you will never get to use and learn the tactics that the people in level 4 are using, because they are using the better tactics, the more effective tactics, that your simple tactics, the smaller jumps that worked in level 1, don't work anymore. Tactics such as these. The domain that Luigi has bought is the one on the back. It's a domain he will be using to build a website to attract the princess to him. What makes this domain look spammy? Well, I don't think this website will have much credits in 2014 anymore. Nobody would build a global brand and try to include a... Wow, that's a difficult word in English. That? A jaartal? Anyone? Yeah. A year. Wow, that wasn't a difficult word. Nobody would include a year in its URL if they are trying to rank a global brand past the year that that event was in. What's also odd is the fact that he chose a .info top-level domain. While it isn't necessarily a bad choice, as I was reminded the last time I gave this presentation, it isn't optimal either. .info, it's always associated with, hey, was the real domain not available? Was .com already sold? Couldn't you get the local top-level domain, such as .nl or .dk or .de for Germany? Lastly, the fact that he used a lot of dashes in his domain isn't a good sign either. It's probably a result of the fact that the domain without the dashes was already taken, which caused him to take the domain with the dashes. Once again, dashes are not necessarily a bad signal to have in your domain, But if you have to use two or three to actually use the name that you want to use, it's not good anymore. People get confused, people start typing in your domain without the dashes, and they will very likely land on a different website than the one you intended them to land on, which is your own. What he has done well is the fact that he included his keywords in his domain name so that people landing on the website at least have a clue what the website is about. Second, what Luigi has done is include a lot of references to Princess Peach. He has mentioned her in his title tag repeatedly, his bold tags, his H1 tags, his image alt tags, his body tags, his texts. As much times as he could include the phrase Princess Peach, he tried. Because after all, if you're including a text more, Google will most likely think the website is more targeted at that phrase, right? It used to be like that in the starting of the 21st century. Right now, that's not true anymore. Google is getting smarter and smarter, and the way to look at it is nearing more and more what a visitor wants to see, Google wants to see. If you are reading a text and every four words I'm including the key phrase Princess Peach, you wouldn't like that text and you would stop reading very fast. The same applies to Google. Google can now see, well, deduct in the case of Google, that a text you've written is not optimized for humans, but is attempting to game the system in hopes of getting higher rankings at Google. Raise your hands, please. Who has used his meta keyword stack to optimize his website? Each one of you has wasted his time by doing that. Google has announced in an official announcement, which I rarely do, that the meta keyword stack is not used in any way for their system to rank websites. In fact, in another presentation I've given earlier, I've described a tactic in which you can use the meta keyword stacks of your competitors by viewing them in the page source to find out new keywords opportunities for your own website. So instead of trying to optimize for Google, you're optimizing my website. I'm very thankful for that, but I'm not sure that's the way you were trying to go when you were optimizing your meta keywords. Link exchange. A popular tactic, most often used by people who are just starting out in the SEO land, because after all, it's really easy to do. The thing about it is, the more easy it is to do, the lesser the value Google will assign to it. And since this is a very easy tactic, Google won't assign much value to it. I described this effect earlier by saying, if you link to my website, this will give me 10 points of link value. If I link back to your website, the value I get is only 7 points, rather than the 10 I got earlier. Those points are made up, by the way. Because he links back, Google might think, hey, it could be that those guys are trying to game the system. After all, they're linking back and forth. Google's not sure. Google's rarely ever sure about anything. But based on the vast amounts of data they have, they can deduct that if we link back and forth, and perhaps with you, and with you, and with you, the more of those so-called reciprocal links I have, the larger the chance that I'm trying to game a system. Well, it's not necessarily a problem to have reciprocal links. I mean, most of the guys in the Joomla industry are linking to me, and I am linking to most of the guys in the Joomla industry these days. It's not a problem. But if you can get one-sided links from somebody, it's far more valuable than providing them a link back, as is the deal with a link exchange, hence the word. You can get more power from those links. Link directories. During the time between that I made this presentation and today, this actually became a far more interesting story. What Google has done about 4 or 5 days ago is de-index a lot of link directories. So the links you've submitted to these endless and endless pages containing only links actually disappeared from the index. Rather than even dampening their effect, their positive effect on you, it might either give you a negative effect because you were included in those indexes, which clearly were a shortcut method of trying to rank, and the links have been removed. So the chances of having a positive effect are really small already. And I will one-up that, I should have added that. I will one-up that once more. The power that a link will give you is divided by the amount of links on a page. For example, if you link to me and there are 10 links on your page, of which mine is one, I get 10% of the potential link value that his page can pass on. If he adds 90 more links, which totals up to 100, I get only 1% of the potential value. I'm sure most of you have seen those link directories. They contain often many hundreds of links. So the potential value of that link is marginal. Another popular tactic. Which one of you owns a blog and isn't bothered by spam comments? Hands, please. There's always a guy with a hand. It amazes me. There's always one or two guys who raise their hands. We should talk. And many people are bothered by these spam links, as was apparent in this hall. What these spam bots are trying to do is add links to your blog in hoping to get value from those. The thing is that most blogs these days have a rel is nofollow implemented. This is a system developed by Google and other large search engines in which you can basically tell a search engine, do not count this link. I will not flow any value from my page to the page that is being linked to. For those who want to try to look it up on Google later, rel is nofollow. If you type that in, you will find countless pages explaining the phenomenon, how to apply it globally, site-wide, or on a specific page. Lastly, in the tactics used by Luigi is automation. Luigi got bored. He didn't want to enter all the spam comments himself anymore. He got bored of typing comments on forums, and he tried to automate it. Problem with automation is that we have CAPTCHAs these days, those illegible characters you have to type over in hopes of getting where you want to be. And there are several new tactics being developed, such as honeypots, which collect spam comments. And when somebody tries to submit a spam comment, it is routed through their system. And when a comment is marked as spam, it doesn't even get posted on the website anymore. Next up, Wario. By the way, if there are any questions, just wave, and I will try to answer it as good as I can. Wario has gotten the dungeon, as he should, because he's using black hat tactics which aren't legal. Do you notice anything particular about the story behind me? I sure as hell hope you don't, because I checked really well if there are spelling errors. Now there's something noticeable. That same word that was just not underlined, I now underlined it. But it was always a link. If Google checked that page we are viewing now, Google will see a link. But what the webmaster did was remove the link. So if a human visitor checks this page, he sees a perfectly valid text. But when Google views the page, they see a text with a link. Right now, Google is being gamed. They are being manipulated. As a human visitor does not see what you present to the Google bot, you're gaming the system, and Google does not want that. But there's more. This red text was always on that page, except for it was black before. This is what a human visitor doesn't see, and this is what Google sees. Google sees that text, those keywords, are on this page because they are looking at the page source, not at what color that particular link has. There's more. This particular yellow text will only be shown if your IP address is the same as that Googlebot is using. Those people built in server-side code that basically said, if IP address is Googlebot, then show this content. Once again, the system is being gamed. Google is not being shown, but human visitors are being shown. Google doesn't like that. These three tactics, for the ones who want to look it up on Google later, are hidden links, hidden text, and so-called cloaking. If you want to look up more, you can use these terms to get more information. What Wario has done here is create a so-called doorway page. Wario hopes that people will type this phrase into Google, Peach Facebook. Of course, hoping to find the Facebook page of Princess Peach. Wario has bought this domain. This domain will very likely rank pretty well on Google because it's an exact match to the phrase that people are using to find that page. Rather than serving them with valuable content, for example, the Facebook page of Peach, he is redirecting here the traffic to his own website, his own spam domain perhaps, on which he is trying to sell things we don't want to buy. By using this tactic and catching all the traffic that was hoping to find the Facebook page of Peach, he is grabbing that traffic and redirecting it to his own site. Once again, manipulation. Google does not like this type of doorway pages and therefore punishes them. One small remark with this Chia sheet is the microsite. It's often much of a gray area between what's a microsite and what's a doorway page. Microsites are the minuscule subsites within a big corporate website. For example, if Nokia is to launch a new telephone, they will create a microsite that is dedicated to that specific telephone. It will feature some videos, some images, the fact that it's probably not going to sell well because there's Apple phones. Okay, they might not include that. That specific data will be placed on a separate domain or on a subdomain of their regular website and might provide links to the main website. The key feature, the key difference between a microsite and a doorway page is the fact that the microsite actually provides value and a doorway page is just catching traffic and redirecting them as fast as possible. I'm actually really proud of this sheet because it tells an entire story of its own. In Super Mario, this is a really difficult part to get through. You have to jump right on the ledges, until you can move on. If you miss it, you'll fall in the lava and you will die. That's not good. This is signifying the risk that buying link tactics have. You have to take a really big risk if you want to buy links. Google has explicitly and in many occasions stated that they do not support the buying of links. They do not want it. If they discover it, they might de-index your page or otherwise penalize you. It's one of Google's biggest battles against buying links, and ironically, it's a really tough battle for them because in many occasions, a link that is paid for can be a natural occurring process. For example, if that water bottle supplier was to sponsor me and say, hey, if you can promote my water bottles during your presentation, I will give you a link on my website. Did he buy that link? Or did he just casually give me a good bottle of water that I can promote in my presentation? Because of those gray areas, it's often very difficult to state if a link that is bought is actually legal or illegal, but often your gut feeling will tell you whether you want that link or not. What's more about this sheet is the fact that it has a question box. You do not know how much value a link you will buy will provide you. Just like the question box, you do not know what is coming out. Perhaps that link you've bought with a 2-year contract for $200 a month is providing excellent value during the first 2 months, and then a Google algorithm update hits the website and it provides no more value to you. That's 22 months of worthless money spent because of your 2-year contract for a website that will not provide you any value anymore. That's not good. Next. This sheet will be easier when I give this presentation later on. These days you can buy social likes. For those who do not have enough friends or fans to actually get likes on Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, LinkedIn, name it, you can actually buy them. You can go to illegal black markets and say, I would like to buy 1,000 Facebook likes, please. Not to be racist, but no, that's going to be difficult. Many people in countries that aren't well paid, often developing countries, will click on these links. And Google will think, oh, wow, 1,000 links, That's pretty nice. 1,000 Facebook likes. That should be a good website, because a website that gets 1,000 Facebook likes is probably better than the next in line who has zero Facebook likes. Problem with this is that Google has such big amounts of data that they can spot anomalies. When these people in that underdeveloped village will vote up pages from around the world, perhaps even local restaurants based in Chicago, and all the villages around that small village that aren't connected to that black market do not vote up that restaurant in Chicago, Google can spot that anomaly and see, hey, I think we'll just discard all those likes from that small village because something odd is going on. We'll just take the risk of not using all those valid likes because too much spam signals have been triggered and the likes from that village are probably not ones that we want to use in our ranking algorithm. Google has not yet officially stated that they are discarding or not counting these social signals. I don't think it will take long, or they will just assume the SEOs of this world will stop buying these social likes because they're just not working anymore. Mario's up next. Mario's tactics stand really well in the daylight. They are not illegal, they are not shortcuts, they are long-term focused, well thought out, strategized tactics to get higher rankings in Google. What we will discuss first is how Mario will optimize his main targeted page in which he is trying to lure the princess in with. I will show a series of three sheets in which different keywords are targeted. In this sheet, Mario has decided to target his main page with the term princess. There are, on Google, exactly 703 million results for the term princess. However, numbers are really difficult in English. 186,000 people are searching for this term every month. As judged by a tool from a company called SEOmoz, which is a search engine optimization company, the difficulty of this keyword is 71%. The difficulty is measured between 0 and 100%, where 100% is an impossible keyword to rank for, and 0 is the easiest keyword ever, which you can rank for tomorrow if you wanted to. This keyword is getting 71%. The targeting of this keyword is pretty bad. People do not know if I am looking for princess, which is a household appliances producer. Perhaps I am looking for a random princess. Perhaps I'm looking for more information about Princess Diana. Or perhaps I'm looking for Princess Peach. But they don't know that. Another try. Mario has tried to optimize its page for the term Princess Peach. There's only 7.36 million results in Google. While this does sound like a lot of results, it's only 1% of the amount we got in the previous attempt. There's 40,500 searches for this keyword, which is a small percentage of the one we used to have. Competition 55% and the targeting is decent. While there is still possibilities that people are trying to find another keyword than the one they searched for, Princess Peach, we can be fairly certain that they were looking for images or text about that fictional princess. Luckily for me, Wikipedia featured that princess actually had a third last name, which is Toadstool. So Mario decided to optimize his page again, this time for Princess Peach Toadstool. 316,000 results, which is only a fraction of the 703 million we started with. Only 130 people are searching for this term, which isn't much. But we know for sure that all these people who are searching for this term are looking for what we are providing to them. 36% competition and excellent targeting, because we know for certain that persons who are searching for this will be looking for what we are offering. To draw this a little closer to the real world, I'm using the famous Nike running shoes example. Instead of targeting princess, somebody could target shoes. anybody who was looking for shoes, male, female, large, small, would type in the term shoes. The chances of that page on which somebody would land actually selling a shoe to the searcher are really small because of the enormous diversity in search engine traffic that it's getting in. Yes, a lot of people are searching for it, but that can mean an enormous range of types of shoes. If you had instead targeted your page at Nike Men's Running Shoes 2012 Edition Black, and I am offering exactly, I can't repeat that because I just made it up, that type of shoes, the chances of converting that searcher are way larger than the ones before. If those shoes are on stock, if there are not too much shipping costs, and if I provide a nice support tool, there's a very large chance I will sell those shoes to that person, rather than when I had optimized the page for shoes. Anybody who wants to read more about this concept can Google for long tail search. There's actually a really good book written about that, which I can advise to anyone who has time left. It describes this concept in far more detail and is stating that the entire world is moving towards a long tail concept rather than the editor picked concept that we used to have with the top 40s in music. We can now download Spotify and listen to any type of music we like, whether other people think it's popular or not. A persona. Personas are marketing concepts. A persona can be seen as a visualization of your target audience. I like to use Sander Potjer as my persona. He's not here, so we can gossip about him. A persona can be used to see if what you are writing or what you are producing or what you are selling will click with your target audience. Normally when people are talking about their target audience, these are very vague concepts. They know something about it. Nah, I'm sure they will like that type of product. Or I think they can pay that more expensive product that I'm releasing. If you create a persona and you decide what type of behavior your target audience is showing, you can actually talk with different departments about this. You can say, I'm writing a blog post, and I want to make a joke about drinking too much beer. Does Sander appreciate this? I know for a fact that Sander likes to drink a beer every now and then as well. So I don't think he would have a problem with this. On the other hand, if I were writing a blog post for the AA, the Anonymous Alcoholics Anonymous, I don't think my joke about drinking too much beer would land well. If you start thinking about your own target audience, for example, perhaps your target audience is a well-educated male, 30 to 40 years old, you can assume that you can use slightly more difficult words in your content than where your target audience was high school educated 14-year-old girls. No gender jokes intended, that was pure coincidence. By knowing more about your target audience, of which I have only listed a few characteristics that a persona includes, you can target your sales better, you can target your products better, you can better deduct how much money you can ask for your products, and as we will be discussing later, you can better target the content you will be producing for them. Mario has looked up the data about his potential partner. This princess is single, about 25-year-old, female, she's rich, she is high educated, and she lives in the fictional Mushroom Kingdom. With all this data, Mario now knows far more about the content he could produce to attract the princess towards him. But he needed one more thing. What is this princess doing? What is she thinking about? What are the problems she is trying to solve? What is she doing on the weekend? Luckily, we know that, because this princess likes to run a kingdom. She likes nice jewelry. She's wearing a gorgeous dress. She likes to play golf, she likes to fight, she likes to play card, and she loves tennis. We know that from other Mario games in which the princess is starring, and she's doing really great at those things. Now let's combine that knowledge. We know the princess is young, attractive, and female. And We know that she loves to play golf, play cards, and play tennis. What if we were to write or produce information that would actually click in with those features? That's inbound marketing. Rather than trying to push out your information to other people, like putting banners on other pages, putting out flyers on schools, or any other way of trying to reach your audience, we are trying to do that in the inbound way of getting people to come to us. You do not have to spend your AdWords credit anymore. You do not have to buy flyers. You do not have to spend any money on a limited term to get people towards you. Instead, you just produce awesome content that will make people want to come to you, free of charge. Well, except for the production of the content, but free of charge for an unlimited amount of time. That PPC campaign you're running will run out once your money is out. Even if you had produced a piece of content that's excellent and you run out of money, that piece of content will still get people in without any extra charges, except for the hosting, to get these people towards your website. Inbound marketing, how do you do that? For example, using a blog. What if we were to write a blog post targeted at nice dresses for princesses? The best earrings that princesses should wear? How to lead a kingdom? How to improve your tennis swing? Knowing what we do about what motivates the princess and what she does on her weekends, we can actually produce targeted content to get these people in. For example, if I were building clocks, I could write an article about why a clock is always ticking. I once wanted to find more information about that because I was looking for a clock that didn't tick. Apparently they don't exist. Why is that clock ticking? If somebody had provided information about why clocks are ticking and perhaps had a nice link below his article, we sell non-ticking clocks, chances were very large that I would have actually considered buying that clock from them. And not from that other company that had spent money on PPC trying to lure me in with, oh my god, awesome clocks. If you can put that content out and attract people in, that's a way more scalable and effective strategy of getting people towards your website than putting out ads. What other methods do we have to get people towards our website? For example, infographics. Infographics have in the last couple of years exploded in popularity. Well, they were used before on magazines, for example, and sporadically on websites as well. Everything is being turned into an infographic these days. Why is that, you might ask? Because they work really well. What an infographic does is visualize information. Often a difficult scientific report can contain very much valuable information about your company. Except reading it will take a degree in science probably and a lot of hours of reading. What if somebody were to visualize that information and use some nice shapes and get that information to me in under a minute? I would want to share that with other people who I might think have the same problem. I would tweet about that graphic, but I would never tweet that scientific article because I wouldn't want to bother my friends with so much information that took me hours to process. I'm very curious, this is a more difficult audience than I'm used to, in terms of Dutchness. How much of you know both of these infographics? That's either Dutch guys or persons who've been to Holland before. How much of you knew one of these infographics? That amazes me. The infographic on the left was produced by my company Theme Partner as an attempt to visualize the history of the Dutch Joomla days. What we did was we outlined where they were held, how much people came, male, female, and of course the amount of beers and wines that were drank during these events. The image on the right is a flowchart that describes whether or not you should upgrade your current 1.5 Joomla website to Joomla 2.5. If you had taken that information and put it into a blog post, it would at least be 2,000 words long, probably way too detailed, and I don't think anybody that knew that infographic in this hall would have seen it then, that information. By making it visual, by making a flowchart of it, it got an enormous reach. I think this was actually our most successful marketing attempt that we did. And we are producing quite a few blog posts a year. But just taking the time to make it visual and make it snap so that people could actually see and use this information, we got a really big reach. People were tweeting about it, people were linking to it, people were talking about it. By just producing this one graphic, Robin won't like the fact that I said just, because he spent a really high amount of time on it, but by just creating that one graphic, we got an enormous reach of attention, of links, of tweets, of likes from people that we might otherwise have never have reached. Another thing that Mario has done is he bought this domain. Rather than the domain I showed you earlier that Luigi had bought, this domain is really old. It has a great authority. It's .com, it's short, it's clear, and an important fact, it was always about Princess Peach. If Mario were to buy the domain princess.com, Google would start questioning all the likes that went into that domain earlier. If Mario buys princess.com and decides to build a website on that about Princess Peach, Google will start questioning, hey, all those likes, all those links that went into that domain earlier, when it still was about kitchen appliances, do they still matter for that domain about Princess Peach? Would all those people have liked and linked to that page if it were about Princess Peach back then? That's an important reminder for everyone who wants to buy a domain in terms of their link quality. Be sure that you're talking about the exact same thing the domain was about. Otherwise, Google might just draw a line in the sand and say, okay, all those likes and links that were happened before January 1st, those move over. And the new ones, hey, we're starting to count that one because they were about Princess Peach. They refer to people liking Princess Peach website rather than that princess website that was about kitchen appliances. Sorry. No problem. Conferences, like the one we're at, are a great way of doing inbound marketing. You get to meet your target audience. If you speak, you will reach even more people because, yeah, well, I'm reaching you guys right now. You get face-to-face contact, you might sponsor an event, and the most important thing is you're actually talking to your target audience. People in this room could either be my customer or know people who could be my customer. Rather than on the street, especially with a distributed virtual company that many of us have, I can never see my target audience. These people are living in countries that I will probably never visit. And perhaps even in small villages that if I were to visit their country, I would never visit exactly them. Well, at conferences, these people come to you. They group in one place so that you can meet them and talk to them about what's bothering them about your products, why they are buying it, why they aren't buying it. It's a great way of just being with your target audience and asking those questions, seeing them, interacting with them, something you couldn't have done otherwise hadn't you went to one of these conferences. Smart boy that Mario is, he decided to get in contact with Princess Daisy, which happens to be Princess Peach's best friend. Of course, this refers to friends and people around your target audience. They will know what keeps your target audience up at night. Rather than talking directly to them, which is not always possible, if you, for example, follow people on Facebook or on Twitter, or you like them on Pinterest to see what they are doing, what they are talking about, you actually know what is keeping your target audience up. Like Mario has done, he has hooked up in a strictly friendly way with Princess Daisy, and he can now talk on a daily basis with her to ask, hey, what's the Princess Peach doing? Will she be in town tonight? Is he seeing anyone? He can ask direct questions about his target audience to see what's happening around them. What are they doing? An excellent way to keep in touch with your target audience is social media. You can follow your target audience on Twitter, you can like them on Facebook, or on one of the other countless social media signals that we have these days. Social media channels. And social media signals also count. While it hasn't been officially confirmed by neither Google nor any of the other search engines, people in the SEO industry are assuming that the more likes you get, the more tweets your domain gets, the more pins you get at Pinterest, the more people are joining your company at LinkedIn, the better your domain will rank. This is pretty intuitive. After all, if a lot of people are talking about your domain, there's a large chance this domain will be good and you're offering a quality service. In fact, Google has even gone so far that they now can deduct the sentiment of a message. So for example, if you were to write a very negative review on Yelp about a company, Google will deduct that the review was negative and not give too much link value for that link. Well, if you were stating, oh my god, this website is awesome, you should all visit it, it's the best website in the world, Google will see, hey, that's a positive smiley. Let's add one piece extra of link value to that link, because that person was so enthusiastic, I'm sure he really, really wants to recommend that website. So, social media. Just one more challenge. Somebody played Super Mario. The last thing you have to do in a Super Mario game is reach that hammer, beacon, I'm still not sure what it is. But first you have to pass evil Bowser. Rather than calling him Bowser, I called him Matt Cutts. Matt Cutts is known as the lead of the web spam team at Google. And people are often referring to him as, well, the final boss of Google, the Google search department. Anything you do will, well, not in person, but be judged by Matt Cutts and his team. Are you using spam tactics? Bowser will come get you. Are you trying to manipulate the system? Bowser will come get you. As long as you're doing what Mario does, we can jump over him and pass the evil, well, not evil, the final boss, Matt Cutts, and you can get to where you want to be. Which is there. I actually had to Photoshop that result because it's not the number one domain, but that's a detail. Mario has used the tactics I just described, the inbound marketing, content-based, long-term focused, strategically charged tactics, and he reached the number one spot. I will show on the last sheet whether Mario succeeded in his mission. I've covered a lot of grounds, I'm sure there's a lot of questions. I saw the 10-minute mark, which means I now have about 7 minutes to answer any questions. Please raise your hands.
You said that you will optimize your site for printed speech.
Mm-hmm.
What actually does it mean? Do you put this name, are you talking in the content about printed speech? Or what exactly means optimization for one term?
What in this case I meant with the optimization for Princess Peach was that I would optimize one specific page for that keyword. Because it's such an important keyword to have on this website, such an important page, I would pick like the second page in my main menu and call that link Princess Peach. I would add it to the title tag, I would display an image of the princess with a great alt tag, and I would put it in the content about 3 times, casual.
So header tags help. For example, if you write an article about which is titled about Princess Peach.
Yeah. If you had a great article about that, and you optimized it in the on-page SEO, the part in your own website, there are kind of fluid guidelines for that. The advices: where should you put your keywords and where shouldn't you put it? people will likely start linking to that page when they are referring to Princess Peach. They might use an anchor text, the clickable link text, mentioning the word Princess Peach. These are all signals to Google that this page is valuable. If you mention Princess Peach on that page naturally, repeatedly, Google says, hey, that page must be about Princess Peach. People are voting for that, they are linking to it, they are liking it, and the page will slowly rise for the keyword Princess Peach. A page can't rank for a word that's not on it, because why would Google otherwise move people towards that page if they are searching for that phrase? Other questions? Really?
I got a customer, and he wanted to have a kind of a landing page, and I told him, okay, please put unique content on it, but he doesn't want to go too much into deep, into the depth of the content, keep it relatively basic, but a subject on the product he's selling, and then just to link normally with a click to his main website.
Yeah.
So, how good or bad is that? So I just basically I just try to explain why what's important about the product. It's telephones for companies.
Yeah.
And how things developed in the past to the present day, and why it's important just to have a reliable and knowledgeable business partner.
The answer to that is probably simpler than you might imagine. Is the page offering value above and beyond the main page about that particular subject? Then it's not a worthy page, and I would find a different way to market that particular way on his website.
Do you have any advices for those people who have had microsites being taken out by the last Penguin update?
What he was referring to in the Penguin update was the latest algorithm update that Google processed, the latest large one, which took out a lot of pages, including many micro pages. Are you sure it was killed by the Penguin update and not by Panda, because that's closer related? It was another.
Or 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, they developed in 3 days in a row. There was one on the 21st of April and one on the 24th. But it's a detail. Microsites that were killed probably match up really close to the answer I just gave him. Those pages probably contained very thin content, no in-depth content, no links out, no, they didn't have social likes. Google was with his algorithm deciding that this page wasn't above and beyond valuable to the page it was linking to or the product it was trying to describe. What a lot of companies have done in the past is just create an entire blast of microsites. Rather than creating one corporate website on which they would list all their products, they would just create microsites for all their products in hopes of trying to rank high on it. It has a separate domain name. You can include those words in the title tag more efficiently. Google has decided that these pages often were not valuable to their searchers. And in this particular update, Google has probably removed those. What the people can do that own those microsites is incorporate them in their big brand website. That big brand website probably has the social signals, it has the high average on page time, it is mentioned in the other media, it is showing all signals of being a strong brand. If they include their product pages on that domain, Google will see, hey, that's a strong brand offering a range of products, rather than, hey, there's a microsite, don't know where that belongs, hey, another one.
But will they also accept if you use a subdomain on your main domain?
I'm not sure to answer that in relation to the latest Google updates, but normally subdomains are treated as different websites that at max receive a couple percentage of link power and value from and authority from their main domain.
So we're still in a gray area.
Yeah, I'm not sure how the latest updates affected that practice. Normally, if you want to create a page on your own domain that doesn't get the authority and the link power of your main domain, you should put it on a subdomain. But there are very few occasions in which a subdomain is actually the best solution for a problem. Not seeing any more signs, so...
On a lot of Drupal websites, in footer, there's a link going back to the company that developed it.
Yeah.
So on every page, how does Google look at that?
A very timely question. In the latest Penguin update, the one that's actually rolled out at April 24th, that changed entirely. Well, in the past it was great. People were having thousands and thousands of backlinks with customizable anchor text coming in. What Google has done is say, yeah, it was too easy for those web designers to put those links there. Those people did not voluntarily put up a link and say, hey, that is a great domain about web design in Yorkshire. No, that was the web designer who put it there, and the customer simply didn't know how to remove it. That's not the type of link that Google is trying to get. Google will want naturally, voluntarily true links. They are trying to get as most of those and as few links they don't links that a user does not want to have on his website or does not know how to remove. To get back at the actual question, those site-wide links that are often on pages that do not have much authority are actually harming your link profile at the moment. Most likely causing a term such as Web Design Yorkshire to be your top linked anchor text. And such as I described before, with their masses of data, they can actually see that is not a natural link profile. Because a natural link profile would have the company name as first and highest amount of links. Secondary, the full URL, because people are linking out full URL. And perhaps third or fourth, one of your primary keywords. If you are manipulating, because it wasn't manipulation a month ago, if you are manipulating the search results by putting all those anchor text in your footers, Google will see this and say, that's not naturally acquired, we will deduct those. What they have in fact done for the templates that we're releasing is only show the link on the main page of our customers and provide them with a switch to remove it. So a percentage of the people will remove it, which is lowering the amount of links we get from them. But it does make it a voluntary move. They want to have that link there. And by only showing it on the main page, it reduces the number of site-wide links. And therefore, it lowers the amount of root domains. Domain names in relationship to the number of pages that are in linking. For example, if I had five of my customers had a site-wide link and each of them had 100 pages on their domain, I would have 500 inlinks coming from only five domains. This is suspicious. The chances of that happening naturally are really small. If I were to remove the links from all their pages but their homepage, I would have 5 and 5. Which is far more natural, because a normal link would come from one place and link to one other page on my website. So if you want to, what very many, especially free template and theme providers are doing, is removing those links as fast as they can in updates and new releases, because their link profile is harmed so badly by it now that it's not providing any value anymore. In fact, it's deducting their normal value they would get. Very long answer. No more questions? Be like Mario and you get the princess.